Hello, I'm Naveen. I'm from Semantics3. To give you an overview of what we do at Semantics3, we provide data intelligence as a service to major e-commerce websites. Some of the tasks we do are unsupervised content extraction, where given a web page or models, machine learning models tend to give the structured data of it. And then there is categorization thing, where most of the e-commerce websites might not have data. So they give small tags to us, and we tend to give the expanded structured data of it. That comes under categorization. And we also deal with feature enhancement, where if a website or if a seller doesn't have particular metadata related to a particular product, we tend to even do that through machine learning models itself. On rough scale, these are the basic applications that we deal with. But on a bigger scale, we deal with so many machine learning models like product matching, image search, and various other things. Today I'll be discussing slightly on that other side of machine learning, that is production level, not on the server level but on the mobile itself. I'll go through. I'll have a slight introduction of what deep learning is, rather than directly jumping onto the task of how to learn deep learning models on mobile itself. Basically, if you take out this term and Google out, Google things out, you have so many technical definitions around it. Most of them might be mathematical oriented. I thought I'll give a simple statement on it. It is a part of machine learning, which is easy to remember. So I thought I'll go with this definition. But this leads to another question, which is, what is machine learning? Again, if you Google out, you will have more mathematical definitions around it and more complex definitions around it. I thought I'll simplify this, and I define it as, is a part of artificial intelligence. Now, these two definitions are pretty simple, part of something bigger. So let's go and this all leads to bigger question, right? What is artificial intelligence by itself? You keep on hearing a lot of this term these days. When a system tends to do decisions, something related to human perception or visual perception, speech recognition, and all those things. When a system tends to do whatever human can do, then that particular system is said to be artificially intelligent. Either it be visual perception, or language translation, or speech recognition, or various other things. But I kind of define the entire artificial intelligence itself as a system which can make random decisions. But when that random decisions tend to be more accurate or more relative to what human can do, that kind of process is called artificial intelligence. And this leads to our previous statements, machine learning and deep learning. So machine learning by itself is a part of artificial intelligence, but it is more of a process which makes artificial intelligence more intelligent. Like, it is the process which makes that random decisions more relative to the human intelligence. And deep learning is a particular technique of machine learning which kind of works. Basically, machine learning is your formula which makes decisions happen. Deep learning is a better formula, better version of the same machine learning, which tends to give better results. I wanted to give slight introduction on the difference between machine learning and deep learning, even before going into deep learning modules of mobile itself. So basically, on a rough scale, let's assume that you have an image and you have to predict what is there in the image. Assume there is a car and you have to predict it's a car or not car. So 4 or 5 years back, how the machine learning models used to work out is, you have something called feature extraction and classification technique, where feature extraction is, you have set of rule-based features based on the image, which will only work for this particular type of task, and then you give it to classifier, that tends to classify things. What deep learning does is, it adds both feature extraction and classification to a single module called as deep learning module, or nowadays people tend to call it as neural network itself. So what it does is, based on the number of examples it has, it internally has feature extraction itself. The advantage with this is, in the first case, if your application has to change from car to bike, then your feature extraction has to change and the entire classification model has to change. But whereas here the module itself is matured enough to figure those things out through data and predict things. That's why most of the deep learning modules tend to work out these days, because it understands through data itself rather than going back and doing things. So as we have slight introduction of what deep learning is, thought it's better to give few examples which are which have been used these days. Like your voice assistant, most of your voice assistants and phones are deep learning based, Siri or Cortana. Your language translation, Google Translate, entire Google Translate itself is on deep learning itself. Your photo or video editors, one is Google Photos, where if you have noticed recently, most of your photos tend to give tags of who's there in the photo and what is there in the photo, and that is entirely deep learning. And Flow is something which we'll be discussing throughout, because that is an app which we developed, and it is more of a video editing app. The last part is recommendation systems. Though the companies you see are Netflix, Spotify, Google, or might not be entirely related to recommendation system, but their main product itself, I think, is a recommendation system. Netflix people prefer because the recommendation system is far better. Spotify, the same thing. Google is the biggest AI company ever known to anyone because the recommendation system works pretty good, and the entire module is in the deep learning itself. So these are the basic applications. I thought I'll go through the presentation on a technical point of view, but again, I figured out it would be easier to present the entire presentation as I faced, as I had my journey through. So I'll explain what we tried to develop as an app, then what are the problems we faced, then how we overcame them. So basically, the app is called Flow. We have the tagline called "Create stunning stories automatically." This is nothing but if you have huge video content, give the entire video content to app. You have 5-minute video content which you can share online. Like if people are aware of action cameras, you have action cameras, people did shoot a lot of video content. To sit on the video content and edit them is skill-oriented task. So we wanted to automate the entire task, and that is what app does, and it is native on phones itself. Same thing I said, manual editing this is very skill-oriented task. If you have 20 or 30 hour video content, you have to sit through and pick things. Rather than that, let there be a tool which can make you do all those things. Like in a text document, if you want to search something, it is easy to do with Control F. But what if there is a video content? Can we do the same with the video content? That is what app does in the background. I think I'll show you a small demo, not demo, but a video, which is a promo of our app. Maybe that will give you a slide. I think as the video says, it is more of the entire point is have AI do your work of manually annotating the video content or manually going through the video content and segregating the video content so that you can edit things. So the entire concept is how we added intelligence to it. That is what I'll be discussing throughout the presentation. I think that is what the entire concept of deep learning on mobile itself is. So as an app itself, there are so many complex modules around it. If we, as most of your developers, you are aware that when there is a video content, video editing kind of apps, you have more problems like streaming, where different kind of videos have to be clubbed together and you have to sync music to it. Those by itself are very complex problems which are out of scope of this presentation. Right now, we'll be discussing only on particular module, but deep learning module, where given a video content, we'll generate metadata so that metadata is being used by other machine learning models to come up with a structured output of a video. So as I said, app, there is a module, you have scene, activity, emotion. Scene are nothing but given a video content, what kind of scene it is, like is it a natural beauty like sunshine or sunrise or something like that, or activity, whether the dancing or what kind of activity is happening, and emotions, like what are the emotions, are there people laughing there, something like that. So this module is something which we'll be discussing throughout in next few minutes. As I said, so this is not, I won't be discussing how to develop your own machine learning modules itself. It's more of how to push them into production mobile. So I'll discuss, assuming that you already have some machine learning model where given input it predicts output, from there we are starting. So I'll say the approaches we try to push the same thing onto the mobile. So one is the easiest one, where your entire model is somewhere on the server and you try to communicate through server. That is server based approach. Next, wraps around existing libraries itself. Rather than doing the server approach, why not write the wrappers of your development code and try to predict in the mobile itself. Then the third part is around implementations. Rather than using the wrappers at all, because there might be few memory errors and all those things, write your own code such that native code, such that it all works. Finally is hardware specific libraries. I think I'll go in detail on these things individually. First is server based approach, which I said, we had video, deep learning module, and all the three activities or three entities there. But let's keep out the deep learning module out of the frame, and let's add something called as communication module. So what this communication module does is, it takes your video content, pushes to the server, and on the server the codes are the same. The development codes itself are there, slightly modified ones. You pass your entire transfer data on the server, run your model, let the results come in, and transfer back the results to communication model. And that communication model again gives the entities, and this all entities are independent. So this particular module will be entirely separate. As I said, this entire application is based only on the video and image content. So there are few issues if you have to go through that. First is latency in transferring and receiving the data. So basically, when I say image and video content, most of the content is not KBs, mostly in MBs or even JBs. When you're taking high resolution images or videos, and transferring something like JBs is not good for the entire app itself. Next is uses of internet data. Whenever the transfer, whenever this thing is happening, this entire thing is happening on users' data, and most of the users are not willing to do it because the size of the data which you're transferring is high. And the biggest concern is privacy. Nowadays, I mean, it's a main thing out of even before these two things, I think. No user wants to send their data in a raw format outside. So I think it's these three things stopped us to make to push the entire model to production itself. So we didn't go through this route. One thing we figured out is something, we cannot send the data to server and process things there and come back. We have to somehow make it run locally itself. So we know that we have to run locally. So that leads to the next three approaches which we have, where wraps around existing libraries itself. Luckily, so deep learning or machine learning itself is so matured, you have so many resources on there to develop your own modules. So the famous libraries are TensorFlow and KFA. So both of them have been supported by bigger companies, like TensorFlow Lite is being supported by Google, KFA is supported by Facebook. So both of them have, both the libraries have this mobile wrappers around it. One is TensorFlow Lite, other is KFA to go. I'll go in, so we implemented these things. I'll explain what are the advantages each of them and what are the disadvantages. And this entire presentation, we won't be discussing on how to do things, rather we'll discuss on what to do and what not to do, because how to do is slightly out of scope. TensorFlow Lite, pros. This is easier to push from development to production and reiterate over, because the library itself, as I said, is developed by Google. So the consistency wise, the API calls and everything are more consistent, where whatever the calls are there on the development side, similar calls could be used at the production side itself, because the ease of the API calls. And the environment itself is stable, there are not many two memory leaks or out of scope problems, so that works out. The biggest disadvantage is slow inference. Slow inference is nothing but each image or each video takes, I mean, the time takes taken for each video to predict something, like, which is very slow using TensorFlow Lite. I'll give you the profiling details in the next slides. The other big problem is big model size. So apparently your deep learning model, what happens to the deep learning modules is, they tend to be very big. If your application is slightly complex, then the deep learning models tend to be even bigger. In our case, it was around 1.5 GB. So we couldn't push the models either as an app bundle, or again, we couldn't upload it into the database and make user download them. So this is one big problem which we'll be trying to solve in next slides. The next library is Cafe2Go. Again, it's from Facebook, so it has its own advantages. Easier to push from development to production because the app is, the library is decent enough. And it's slightly faster than TensorFlow, maybe because it got released recently, 2 to 3 months back, where it is slightly hardware specific, at least on the iOS side, not on Android. So it is slightly faster than TensorFlow Lite. The disadvantages here are the same as TensorFlow Lite. Slow inference, where given an image, it takes a lot of time to predict. Big model size, same problem again. But it has one more bigger problem. This kind of unstable environment, which I think maybe because it started like 2 months back, the coding wise, there is slight inconsistency in the library itself. So it tends to have so many memory leaks and all. So it is not suggestible to go with it if you're going to production as of yet. Speaking about 1 month backward, not sure how things are, but it's TensorFlow Lite is far better than if you to go as of now, as I understand. So to say, we did experiments on both TensorFlow Lite and Cafe2Go. We went with TensorFlow Lite and pushed the model to production, the entire app to production itself in last December, which had good response, but had slight bad response also. Like, these are the reviews you see. People keep on complaining about the slow speed. For someone, it takes 5 seconds. 5 second video content takes forever. And for some people, the app itself crashes because the model size isn't fit in their memory. So these two are major problems. So this leads to our problems, which are basically processing speed, which we have been discussing in the last two slides also. And the other big thing is model size. So these two have to be fixed in order so that we have to move a step ahead and make mark in the entire video editing app market itself. So we'll discuss how we went through processing speed problem and how we fixed at least. So basically, the problem is not new. Maybe 2-3 years back, it was there on the laptops also, where your codes used to run on CPUs, which used to take a lot of time. So slowly, they started moving the codes to the GPUs, and things automatically started working fast. So we thought, why not use phone CPU itself rather than figuring out at the CPU level of coding? So which leads us to the hardware part. So basically, on mobiles, to say roughly, there is a controlled hardware and uncontrolled hardware. So uncontrolled is more of your iOS, where your hardware is more of, hardware upgrades are more of constant rather than a huge variation in the hardware itself. Android is slightly uncontrolled because of the various manufacturers you have. Everyone has different processor, different chips and all, which tends to be more complex if we have to program it hardware level. So we try to solve everything individually. So firstly, I'll explain how we went through iOS and how we solved the slight things. So Apple has a framework called Metal, which got released last year, years back, I think. So last year, they kind of gave access to their API called Metal API, which is from which you can access their GPUs, GPU power. So we kind of used it. So basically, what GPU does is there are too many cores, can parallelize things. So they gave their multiplication operators, which can run like 20 or 30x faster than your regular CPU multiplication operators. So when I said deep learning, everything is a formula. So what we did is we developed our own modules around that GPU formula, and we developed our own package. In fact, our own SDK for our deep learning module, and we pushed into the production. And these are the speeds. Inception V3 is an architecture of deep learning where mostly it is used for profiling, compare the timings between different libraries. So it used to take almost 2 seconds per image using the CPU TensorFlow code. When we started doing this thing, it boosted up to 120 milliseconds, which is very, like almost, what, 15x, I think. So previously we used to do it 0.5 FPS. Right now we are doing it 8 to 10 FPS, which is very high speed. So this is on the iOS side where we developed our own SDK. I think I suggest the same for everyone else. But last month, iOS itself is, by itself is very, very, very matured coding format. So they released something called CoreML, which kind of does what we did 1 year back. So what CoreML does is it's same. You train your model somewhere on the library, on the open source library set in Sapothian or TFA, and just convert that library using the CoreML converter, which is there open source. Once you convert that, take the model, come back to the CoreML library. There are three calls where you just load the model, predict it, and it predicts. So this is as simple as that, which has been did by CoreML. But apparently they don't have some. TensorFlow is an amazing library by Google, which supports most of the open source models. But apparently for some reason CoreML didn't have that wrapper around it. But as we worked on TensorFlow long back itself, we were able to convert the codes. We had the wrapper for this particular module, so which should be available in the last slide, I think, the GitHub page of that. So this is on the iOS side where we're able to fix the processing speed issue, up to increase it by 15x. In fact, the processing speed got better by 15x, so we were pretty happy with that. And next we had to solve the same problem in Android also. As Android itself is complex environment, we didn't want to go with generic Android. We just wanted to concentrate on specific hardware rather than going for everything. That's when we thought we should go with the phones which have Snapdragon 820 plus, which is your OnePlus 5 and all those phones, I think. The reason for that is 820 and 835 plus phones have this three chips. Apparently 820 has this CPU and GPU in their processor, whereas 835 has CPU, GPU and DSP. I'll explain what are the profiling on each of the different chipsets. So the idea is the same. So Snapdragon came up with their own SDK. As I said, it's a GPU based SDK where you have some formula and you have write wrappers around it, or you can use their existing SDK also, which might be slightly unstable, but you write your own wrappers around it. What it does is you train your model somewhere open source, use TensorFlow or KFI or whatever library you are willing to do, and use open source snippets which are available to convert the weights into specific format, or you save them, those weights into a specific format and load in the memory on the phone itself. So on the profiling part, on the Android, I said, right, 835 plus phone, which is OnePlus 5, I think, we had TensorFlow Lite comparatively was better when compared to iOS on the phone, but it was not good for us. It was taking 1.2 seconds. Then we used Snapdragon GPU, which takes almost 300 milliseconds. It's slightly faster, but Snapdragon DSP is something where things are very fast. It took 120 milliseconds, which is almost equivalent to iOS middle framework. So we were able to reach the same speeds which we had with the iOS side. So that way we are again happy on the Android side itself. And again, all of this is your own modules, not your own modules, your own hardware SDK rather than generic SDKs. The second problem which I said is model size. How do you reduce the model size itself? So basically, when on the deep learning side, when the learning happens, the model gets saved, the values are in the float, in fact not even float, in the double, which is that it was 64-bit precision. So there what in you can't compress them further. So what you do is convert those values. So at the training side you can't do that, because training side it tends to learn the small changes. So it has to be on the server side, it has to do on the float itself. But on the prediction side, which is on the mobile, you can convert those float values into ends, and your model size gets reduced to 4x. The idea is simple, which is like take the maximum value, convert it to 255, minimum value to 0, then normalize your all the values accordingly, and now your values are 8-bit scale, which means that apparently you reduce your entire size from, if it is 1.2 GB, you reduce it to 400 MB or something, 300 MB or something like that. So it is by 4 by default. Again, the operator itself stays the same. So this is basic assume it is a formulae which is there. So you have the values before going to operator, just do the normalization. You have everything on int scale. Now do the operations on int scale and predict back. That's what the operation says. But as I said, when you're doing this float or double conversion to again back to int, there will be slight issues also. It's not that it works like that. The results will degrade. In fact, degrade very bad, that you can't even figure out whether your model is performing good or not. But it depends. Like if you know which layers are important for you and which are not, accordingly you tend to save those particular values as n types and rest you keep in float, and it works. And the other, so we figured out that it is reducing size a lot. But the one thing few of our developers did was, so when we are doing this float to int conversion, we are reducing the size of the model by 4x. And which internally what it does is, so while loading into memory also, we tend to reduce the memory size by also 4x, which gives us more memory to explore. So if you have intelligent programmers around, you can figure out that when there is more memory, you can still make faster. So through that, we have made slightly faster, and varies almost 10 to 12 FPS on the same using the quantization itself. Apart from the quantization, you can do more on the data science part to make the size lesser. But yeah, that's how it works. So this is after the app upgrade. So this we did in March or April, I think. So once we did all the changes, then the results came in, where Apple itself retweeted our entire app, saying that we did something with the AI part. And we were app of the week on Product Hunt. So apparently the good news happened there. That's it. I would like to conclude by saying that it's easy to take up the existing open source libraries and build your own modules and push them to production. But at one point of time, they don't scale up properly because of the issues which they have. So if I have to suggest something, I suggest build your own wrappers around hardware SDKs. The reason for that is, first thing is, the open source libraries which are there are at least 50 to 100 MB, and you don't want to bundle your entire app with that kind of big library. So if you do your own SDKs, what happens is, at the end of the day, all you need is 2 to 3 operators, which might not even cross 1 MB or 2 MB. So your entire library gets down to 1 MB or 2 MB. So it is, which is very good. That's it. If anyone has some questions around it, I'd be happy to take. Yep.
What's your strategy?
So right now we have a limited vocabulary. So right now we determine activity and all, right? We have limited vocabulary of 12,000 words. Whenever that changes, yes, we have to update things. So we can do two ways. So I said, right, you can either bundle the entire model with the app itself, or you can you can update the model inside the database and keep that updated. So in the second case, whenever the model gets updated, you can update your database and accordingly it works out without the app update itself. But I think we didn't have major updates, because our entire application was more specific on that particular region. So we didn't have updates yet. So we didn't go through the process of changing the codes. The code won't change, the model changes, which will be independent of the code. Your code is more of loaded, so it works.